Okay, here we go. So this is about the use of an array. It's more like a philosophical question. It has multiple answers. It says, which is the more appropriate scenario for use of an array in a program? This formulation of the question is not related to C++ implementation. This is the standard mathematical notation that you would use while describing an array. So an array A, for example, is simply described as A equal to the set of values. So there are a total of 6 values, 5, 9, 12, 34, 56, 43. Since this is a conventional mathematical notation, the different elements of an array are represented using indexes 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, etc. To clarify this, it is stated that A1 is equal to 5. So what is the sum of A2 plus A4 plus A6? Very straightforward. Everybody has done this simple sum. Which of the following properties are true for arrays? Again, this relates, of course, to C++. Comment on the properties of arrays which hold for arrays. Choose appropriate answer for arrays in C++. We must declare its name and size. And when we declare the size, the slice could be a floating point number. Just two simple statements made. These all relate to array declarations and array handling. This is definitely a C++ question. An array A of size 5 is defined with initial values 2, 5, 6, 3, 2. What will be the value corresponding to A of this expression? A simple question. If you have seen the lectures, you should be able to answer it very quickly. So here is a code segment, practically lifted straight from a lecture. So those of you who have seen the lecture know exactly what is happening here. It presumes that marks is an array of type int, which is defined earlier. You can also presume that the value of n is less than or at most equal to the size of the array. So if this code segment is run, what does A represent? Standard deviation, average, sum, or none of these? In practice, when you write programs involving arrays, the lectures advise that you should take certain precautions. Some of those are listed here. Whether any one or more are valid or none of them hold for handling arrays. There are the 4 choices here. All right. So here we start the session with a very brief recap. We are going to solve some problems. Increasingly, we will be moving towards writing programs, as Professor Supratik and I have been mentioning. Today, you will have to write code segments, and therefore, listen to these things attentively. The first, of course, is merely a very quick 15-second glance at some of the points related to arrays that were mentioned in the class before we start. So all of you recall from the lecture that if you have an array, it's 100 integer elements, then each element will be allocated 4 consecutive bytes because int is 4 bytes. Consecutive elements are allocated, memory locations are allocated to different elements of the array. The way the array is declared is like this. You write a size, an absolute number, inside square brackets, the name, and define the type of the array. Every element of the array is accessed by an index. So if you want to find out the sum of n numbers, n marks rather, then you declare this marks array, start with sum equal to 0, the array has n elements, so you read n. So basically saying it's like our CS101, there are 600 students, but not all, or 573 students who may give the quiz. So the exact number of students who give the quiz need to be entered here. This is another iteration. This presupposes that marks have been read into the array. No, it is reading array. So as soon as it reads this, it adds the element of that marks to sum, and at the end you output the sum. Okay, now if my intention in life was to find the sum of n marks, do I need an array? Yes or no? If I only want to find sum, I don't need an array at all. I can just read a mark, add it to sum, discard it. In fact, I don't need so many locations. I need exactly one location, just a value to be read. Obviously, arrays are to be used when I have to do something more with these values after finding sum. For example, not just the average, but I have to find standard deviation. A program was discussed in the lecture. Now, if I have to find out standard deviation, I need all individual elements and also the average, which must have been pre-computed before I go to calculate the standard deviation. So therefore, I need to retain this value. In general, there will be many occasions when you will be required to retain and use these values again and again and again in an algorithm. Notice that this is the preferred way we have indicated. You can actually set up a for loop in myriads of different ways. Every individual can decide one's own way. But this is something which has come to be an acceptable, more or less conventional practice in C++, that you start the index with 0, you end the index to be just less than n, because the array goes up to n minus 1, and you increment the array by 1. Count plus plus is also a perfectly acceptable practice, because you are incrementing that count by 1. In the classes, in the lectures, you have seen different ways of handling indexes. During the discussion on the iterative solutions, you have seen multiple things that can be stuffed inside the single for statement. Now, those are very nice things to know, and those are very good things to use when you want to do multiplicity of things. However, as a practice, when you are handling an array and you are just scanning all the elements of an array, whether it is a one-dimensional array or two-dimensional array, the best thing is to set up the simplest loop without any complicated computations inserted inside the for specification. So in English, you should read this like, execute the loop over all elements of the array. That is the purpose, nothing else. This is the first practice problem. So see it carefully. This is a new term that is being introduced. Eratosthenes is a very old algorithm, by the way, to find out all prime numbers up to some n. So what you do is you list all natural numbers. You of course omit 1, because 1 divides everything technically. So 1 is a factor of everything. But you start with 2 to n. Now what you want to do is you want to reduce this long list of all integers, chop off those numbers which have any previous number factor. So 4 is a multiple of 2, you have to chop it off. 6 is a multiple of 2, you have to chop it off. So you keep removing elements of these natural numbers. Once you have done this for 2, you take the next number which is still remaining there, which is not yet chopped off, which is 3, because 3 does not have 2 as a factor. So now you take 3 and scan the remaining elements if they are powers of 3, that is multiples of 3. And if they are multiples of 3, you chop them off. What will be the next element remaining in that list? 2 is over, 3 is over. Will 4 be there? No. 4 would have been chopped off when you looked at 2. So 5 will be there. Now you look at the remaining elements, chop off all those elements which are multiples of 5. You keep doing this, you will end up with only those elements which are all prime numbers. So this is a very simple algorithm. Now what is the equivalent of chopping off? If you are supposed to do it on paper, you may simply cross a number. But you will start with all these numbers, all these natural numbers in an array. So what is the equivalent of chopping it off in an array? Chop, chop. What do you see? C++. I don't want this number. Okay. He has a solution which says, whenever any number is found to be a multiple of any previous number, replace that number with -1. But now when you examine, you'll have to keep checking whether first that number is -1 or not. Because you'll be still scanning the entire array. You don't know which particular position a number has gone. The second possibility is that actually when I remove a number, I physically remove it. Meaning, I upgrade all the subsequent numbers up by one position. So if I have 100 numbers less, and let's say 4 is removed, so I push 5 to the fourth position, the position of 4, 6 to position of 5 and so on, and my array becomes smaller. The third possibility is to use an external flag. Keep this array as is, but have another array, an integer array, which has only, let's say, 0, which means all numbers are not yet marked, and some other number, which means that number is marked. That approach is taken in this practice problem to tell you how, while dealing with arrays, you quite often have to deal with one array, and based on the judgment that you arrive at by examining some element of that array, you do something on the element of this other array. So these are things which are frequently required, so therefore that approach has been taken in this practice problem. There are multiple approaches possible, of course, to implement this algorithm. So to recap again, we know that prime numbers are numbers which are only divisible by 1 in itself. We don't bother about 1, we don't bother about itself, but we bother about any other number less than that. If it divides it, then we forget. So we use this fact to solve the problem. So here is the algorithm. We start with a list of consecutive integers, 2 to n. We assume that all elements are unmarked. That means all are currently, technically, they are all prospective candidates of being prime numbers. Now we mark the lowest unmarked element p and remove all multiples of the p in the list. The lowest unmarked element has to be a prime number. Because if it is not a prime number, it should have been marked in the previous iteration. You're starting with the first number as 2, 2 is prime, and that will be the lowest unmarked number when you start with this algorithm. So when you kickstart, this statement is correct, and you can show easily by induction that this statement will remain valid if the following procedure is executed. So mark the lowest unmarked element and remove all multiples of p in the list except p itself. Repeat steps 2 and 3 until all elements are marked. So keep doing this for the first number 2, then the next number 3, then the next number, which will not be 4 because 4 would have been marked, next number 5 and so on. So here is an algorithm that is given for you to program, structure that is given for you. Is an explanation. All elements left in the list are prime, which are numbers less than n. So let's say n is equal to 14. You will start with this list, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 14. And when you complete the execution of the C++ program that you are going to now write, you should have the output list as 2, 3, 5, 7, 11, 13. The output list does not mean that these will be the elements physically remaining in the array. We said we'll not disturb the array elements, but we'll mark them. So these are the elements which will be output, which would have been unmarked at the end of the algorithm. A fairly simple, straightforward algorithm, but we would like you to write the C++ program in a particular way. You can write multiple variations. As someone suggested, you could use replace a number by -1. That's also an easy way of solving the problem. But in this particular case, you'll solve it like this. The step-by-step execution of this algorithm, just as an explanation for some, because some of you, because you have to set up an iteration. So iteratively, you start by looking at 2. Now, after outer iteration, which you will set for examining all elements, inside each iteration. You'll have to conduct another iteration to scan the remaining elements of the array from this point onward and examine whether any one of them is a multiple. So if you start with 2, remove 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, and 14. The effective new list now is 2, 3, 5, 7, 9, 11, 13. Now you again mark 3 and remove 9. Then in the new list is this. Now you mark 5. You will also mark in success. After you mark 5, there is nothing to be removed. After you mark 7, nothing to be removed. So all of these will remain. So marking is equivalent of doing something, recording it. Putting minus 1 was his suggestion. Putting a separate array is the suggestion that the people who wrote this algorithm have taken. So here is the code line. The outline says, I declared an array called remove 100. This array is a special array. This is not the list of numbers. This is something like a set of flags. It could have been a Boolean array as well, because I just need to know whether true or false. But the person has chosen to use an int array. The array will contain 0 if a corresponding number in another array is not removed, and it will contain 1 if the corresponding number is removed. So that means if there is a list of 100 numbers which I need to examine, there should be 100 elements in the removed array as well, and there should be 1 onto correspondence. The fifth element of that main list should correspond to the fifth element here as far as the flagging is concerned. The way you are supposed to write is, you write a code snippet which will mark all elements with 0. Which elements? The elements of array removed. This is the flag array. How could you have achieved it more simply? Will it assign 5 to all the elements of array? All elements will become 5. Then why, if I say 0, all elements should become 0? So don't make assumptions. The best bet is, if you are not sure of what C++ does, or if you think that a feature is compiler dependent feature, which means it is not guaranteed to run exactly identically on different compilers on different machines, do the Ghodagiri yourself in your program. That is what this program says. This is an extremely simple code that you have to write. The second one is, if I is not removed, then remove all multiples of I less than 100 except I. You will wonder that if this is the removed list, and there has to be a list of actual numbers. This contains, by the way, all zeros initially, so you have to fill this up. You would expect an actual list to contain what? This is what you are going to examine, right? Some of them are going to be removed. For example, this is going to be removed, this is going to be removed, etc. Where is the array? There is nothing called list. There is nothing there. The point is, you don't require an explicit list of integer numbers, because you can use the association between index of this array and the corresponding number. So if you are looking at 4, effectively you are looking at the fourth, at the value of I, some index I. For int I equal to 2 to 100, 2 less than 100, so please note that you are not going to examine this element at all, because it does not exist. It is meaningless. Now, when you are examining I equal to 2, and you are going to mark this element, then you are removing all other elements which are multiples of 2 by simply changing the value of I and marking the ith element of this removed array. You don't require any other array. After all, you want to remember which particular integer number, you don't want to look at subsequent. This single array is more than sufficient. So look at how the problem has been transformed. The problem stated, you start with a list of integers and then mark them. That's what you would do on paper. The problem has been transformed into a removed list. And what does removed list contain? It contains 0 if it is not removed and 1 it is removed. So this list will contain all zeros initially. It will start containing some ones. Where is the list? The list is hypothetical. The list is A in your mind, and in the algorithm, the list is equal to the index of this array. As the index varies, you are looking at that number. So when you vary I is not only index to this array, I is also the natural number which you are examining. The finally, using the array of removed. Now you know the array contains only zeros and ones, nothing else. But using this array, and of course some conditional if, you have to set up a separate iteration to go over the entire array. But the third code snippet says, you have to write output all primes less than 1. All right. Let us quickly look at, instead of having discussions on the solutions that you have found out, 4 people have offered for their solutions to be seen. So let us together analyze these. So just look at the first snippet. This is a solution by Shloka. This one is straightforward. Everybody agrees this is correct. It's almost a trivial thing. You have to set up an iteration for some index equal to 0 to less than 100. And put that jth element to 0. Let's look at the second snippet. Add this outer iteration statement in I equal to 2, I less than 100, I plus plus, already included. So your snippet actually starts from here. By the way, this is serious because in your quiz examinations, and in your test examinations and your problem in the labs, the project submissions or the paper or the program submission, if you are required to write a snippet and submit it as a .cpp file, you have to write only the snippet. For example, if for snippet 2 you write for int equal to I equal to 2, in our autograder, this for int I equal to 2 is already there. Now that will get added to this, and there will be chaos in the autograding. So when you are said write code snippet 2, it means you have to write the code which will exactly fit this. You cannot write whatever is already pre-written. Just remember this from an exam point of view. Here, of course, it is correct because it explains the context, but just remember. So the second code snippets look at every I, value of I. At this juncture, I is being treated as a number. It's not an index of anything. So you have to examine all numbers from 2 to 100, less than 100. So I is that number. Now you examine, what she has done is, to mark numbers 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, whether they are removed or not, she assumes that the marking starts with 0th element, 0, 1, 2, 8. So you have to remove this and go back. It will complicate your logic. I am not sure whether the rest of the logic will be correct then. The output statement also you will have to do that. I can find a fault in your final solution. If removed I equal 0, oh, you are outputting L plus 2, clever girl. All right. So do you now see the logic? You have an iteration for every number I that you take. You have to examine all the numbers k from I plus 1 to less than 100 and examine whether k is divisible by the starting number I. So you just examine k modulo I. If k modulo I is equal to 0, it means k is divided by I. If it is, then k must be marked out, because k is no more a prime. So removed k minus 2 equal to 1, that is because she has a lag of 2 in the removed array. It's a slightly complex. So this solution will work. There is another solution by Nikhil. This is code snippet 2. I am not discussing code snippet 1 because it is trivially understood by everyone. Please note that the outer iteration is already set in the problem. I'd like to remind you this. For int I equal to 2, I less than 100, I plus plus is already set up here. So your code snippet has to assume that you have some valid value of I at this point. If the ith element itself has been removed, then you simply say continue. That means I don't want to do anything with this I. I just go back and take the next element. But if I is not removed, then all multiples of I have to be removed among the subsequent numbers. So that is where this iteration is set for j equal to I plus 1 to n. And if j modulo I is 0, then jth element, I mean jth value is marked as removed. This will also work correctly. This is another one by Chaitanya. Again, I am not discussing code snippet 1. What he does is, he examines if the value of I has not been removed. That means removed I is 0, which means I has not been removed. So I has to be considered. But look at the optimization he is trying here. He is not examining from j equal to 2 to less than n. The point being that if I am examining a certain value I, then I multiplied by something less than n is sufficient. I need not examine the remaining value. If up to that range I have not found any multiple, I will not find any other multiple later. Values of j, where I into j is less than n, only needs to be examined. I don't need to examine remaining values of it. This clever optimization reduces the number of inner iterations to be executed, thereby reduces the amount of work without sacrificing the correctness of the algorithm. Any number which is a multiple, now here is a problem there. I multiplied by jth element is removing. So I multiplied by 2, I multiplied by 3, I multiplied by 4, I multiplied by 5. So instead of actually looking at every number and dividing by I, he is reciting sort of multiplication table of I. And any value which is in the multiplication table is being removed. You agree that I into j is nothing but a multiplication table. And every j is actually therefore of such kind has to be removed. Here is another one by Aniket. He is not optimizing on the number of elements examined, but what is he doing is that if the ith element is not removed in that means I is a valid number to be considered, he is starting j equal to 2 into I. What is the justification, Aniket, of starting for j equal to 2 into I? So he is saying that all numbers below 2 into I would have been taken care of. They would have been either eliminated in the previous iterations or they are primes. So he is also doing the multiplication table implementation in a different way. He has to examine all multiples of I. He is actually not examining anything at all. He is like in our younger days in Hindi we used to say teen duni chhe, teen tiya nau. So he is doing like that. And every time he finds a multiple, he just catches that index and sets it to minus. So all of you have got, these are different ways of solving the problem, but you could also sort it in a straightforward way. Examine all values for j greater than I up to n. Find out whether each value of j is a multiple of I by finding out the modulo remainder and setting the value appropriately. But some of these algorithms are slightly more efficient. Here is another problem. we may not have much time to have discussions on this problem. So we'll continue these discussions even tomorrow, but I would like to discuss this problem today. Everybody is familiar with queue? All of you are familiar with the queue for the bus or something? Well, the kind of disorderly queues that you see at bus stops is not what I am trying to describe here. Here is an orderly queue where a new person coming in always joins the end of the queue and does not join a friend who is standing somewhere in between. When a bus comes, only the head of the person at the head of the queue only enters, and people don't crowd and the last man does not get in. So C++ queues naturally behave in a far better manner than most human beings behave. But this is the queue we are discussing. We want to simulate a queue. A queue can be simulated by using an array. The head of the queue could be the starting point of the array. The tail of the queue could be the other end of the array. Since we can directly access any element, you can access the top element as well as the last element, first element as well as the last element. So enqueue and dequeue are two operations defined here. We'll also discuss a deck later. The enqueue is actually joining the queue. It's an insertion operation that inserts the given new element which has come at the end of the queue. And correspondingly, dequeue is a deletion operation which takes out the element at the start of the queue. Now here we are going to simulate a queue by actually inserting and deleting elements. Insertion is very simple. If there is a place at the end of the array, you insert whatever was the last element, you have to somehow remember it, and that plus next element, you insert the new fellow. Easy. But to dequeue, to let a fellow go and catch a bus, you have to physically remove the fellow. So physically removing means you have to shift all the remaining elements up by one place. Okay? That is how you could simulate. So here are some examples. If you have an array, initially the queue is empty. So the array elements have nothing. Mr. 4 joins the queue. So that is the first element. Now Mr. 5 joins the queue. So now the elements are 4 and 5 because 5 gets added at the last element. 6 joins the queue, 6 gets added at the last element. If you just say dequeue, please note that dequeue function has no parameter. By implication, the first element or 0th element has to be removed. So 0th element is removed and the array queue looks now as 5 and 6 only. Another 8 joins, the queue is like this. 9 joins, the queue is like this. If there is a dequeue, dequeue operation is like this. So this is the question one. Consider the queue 4, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. This is the queue. You can actually define an array and initialize that array to these values. If you put 6 values in brasses, then exactly first 6 elements, 0th, 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 4th and 5th will be initialized, independent of the size of your array. So that is your queue. In fact, you can call that array as queue. Now, you have to perform the following operations in the queue. So what is being written here is a main program with semicolons missing. You define that array and you simply say NQ11, NQ13, dequeue, 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 NQ12. Obviously, you should have to write two functions. One function, which is enqueue, another function which is dequeue. Please note that if you pass arrays in functions, they are always passed by reference, not by value. And this is the second question. I will come back to the first question, so keep it here so you can start writing it. Second question is, what is the minimum number of operations needed to remove 12 out of the queue? You have enqueued 12. Now, when you say how many operations required to remove 12 means, if you have to dequeue 12, how many operations you will have to undertake? How many shift operations, comparison operations, etc. So please note this question down. Have you noted this? I would expect you to actually write down these two functions at home today, because tomorrow we'll have some discussion session and additional problems when we meet. Thank you so much.